She was a killer. She was a serial killer. And there was no man in the world who could match her for the number of people she killed. She killed when people were alone, and she killed when people were in groups. She was silent, stealthy, and lethal. Her victims were male and female, weak and strong, young and old, quick and slow. Her modus operandi had nothing to do with her victim's emotional state. Her victims did not live along the periphery of society, but came from the very hearts of their communities. She attacked her victims at their moment of weakness, when they were coming down. She delivered the death blow suddenly, without hesitation. She was strong, fast, and a brilliant student of observation. Once dead, she kept the bodies around for days. Then she performed her cruelest trick. Of all, she ate her victims, right down to the bone. She was a stone-cold killer, and she claimed more than 430 victims. And when she was on the prowl, nobody, no matter how well armed, would dare to unlock their doors. Welcome to the Podcast of Doom, the podcast devoted to epic failure analysis. A Bengal tiger, a freaking Bengal tiger. There are predatory animals in this world, the killers, the carnivores, and there are megafauna, the large animals, bears, lions, elephants, rhinos. But pound for pound, the biggest, scariest predator in the animal kingdom has got to be the Bengal tiger. Just look at the facts. Bengal tigers can grow up to 11 feet long. An adult tiger can weigh upwards of 675 pounds. That makes them bigger than lions. In fact, they are the biggest members of the cat family. Their canine teeth can grow as long as 3 inches. Their powerful roar can be heard from 2 miles away. Tigers have been known to reach speeds of up to 40 miles per hour. They can swim up to 3.5 miles at a time, can easily jump 15-foot chasms, and can crush an adult human head with the swipe of their paw. Unlike almost all other predators, the tiger will occasionally develop a taste for human flesh, and develop a diet for flesh that needs to be constantly satiated. Our story is about the most lethal of these tigers, the Champawat tigress. She's on record for having killed 436 people in 2 different countries, the most deaths attributed to a single animal. She lived during an era in northern India of increased tiger attacks. She was stealthy, deliberate, and cautious, and attacked humans not out of defense, but due to a change in her diet. For one of the rare times in history, the animal was the hunter, and the humans were the prey. That she carried out these killings in an age of repeating rifles, advanced tracking methods, and organized hunting parties makes this story even that much more remarkable. But the story of the Champawat tiger is really the story of the man who ended her killing spree, Edward James Corbett. Jim, as he was known, kept the best accounts of the pattern of killings by the tiger, the tiger's movements throughout the subcontinent, and her methods. This is a story about Corbett's pursuit of the Champawat tiger and how that tiger struck into the hearts of the people of the Kumaon region in northern India. Corbett was born in Kumaon in 1875 to British parents. He was 4 years old when his father died and his family moved to the small town of Nainital, where his older brother took a position as postmaster to support them. Early in his life, Corbett explored the nearby forests and wildlife. He went on frequent excursions in the wild and developed his skills as a hunter and tracker. He was known for having excellent eyesight, keen hearing, steel trap memory, and superior powers of deduction and observation, along with toughness and courage. He soon developed a reputation as an outstanding hunter of large animals. And in an area plagued with a great number of man-eaters, it was a highly popular skill to possess. Corbett rarely hunted for sport. He hunted the big cats of India because they had turned to man-eating as a mechanism for survival. As he explains, predatory cats do not choose to eat human flesh. They do it because they are unable to hunt or eat their normal prey. A man-eating tiger is a tiger that has been compelled, through stress of circumstances beyond its control, to adopt a diet alien to it, Corbett writes in his book, The Man-Eaters of Kumeon. Most of the time, that stress is caused by a wound which forces the cat to change its diet. On occasion, a big cat will hunt humans because it has gotten old and that factor has forced the change in diet. Says Corbett, the wound that has caused a particular tiger to take to man-eating might be the result of a carelessly fired shot and failure to follow up and recover the wounded animal, or be the result of the tiger having lost his temper when killing a porcupine. Human beings are not the natural prey of tigers, and it is only when tigers have been incapacitated through wounds or old age that in order to live they are compelled to take a diet of human flesh. Tigers stalk their prey through a combination of stalking and lying in wait. It is a game of patience. A tiger depends mostly on its speed to successfully hunt its prey, and much less upon the condition of its teeth or claws. But a tiger that has suffered a wound or an injury to its teeth or claws may not be able to catch and or hold the animals it is used to eating. At that point, in order for the tiger to survive, it must change its natural diet and hunt prey that is slower and less elusive. And humans, which are quite plentiful in the Bengal tiger habitat, fit that description very well. The switch from animal to human flesh is accidental. Corbett gives the example of the Mukhtasar man-eating tigress. This Bengal tiger was a young adult when it apparently lost an eye in an encounter with a porcupine, and during the fight had some 50 quills lodged beneath her skin. The quills, varying in length from 1 to 9 inches, were embedded in her front right paw and up her arm. Some of the quills had hit bone and were curving backwards in a U-shape. Other quills had broken off and were starting to cause infection. The tiger spent much of its time hiding away and licking its wounds. One day, a local woman chose to cut grass fodder for her cattle on a patch of land that was near where the tiger was hiding. At first, the tiger paid no mind to the young woman, till she happened to cut some grass that exposed the tiger's presence. The tigress pounced on the woman with lightning-quick action, crushing her skull with her massive paw. Death was instantaneous, for the next day the body of the woman was discovered, still holding her sickle in one hand and a clump of grass in the other hand. The tiger limped away from the site of the killing and took up another hiding spot over a mile away under a fallen tree. 2 days later, a man came by to chip some firewood from the fallen tree. He removed his shirt and coat before proceeding. Once again, the tiger was exposed, and once again she took the life of another human. Whether it was the smell of blood coming from the man's exposed skin or some other factor, the tiger chose to eat a small portion of flesh from his back. Corbett determined, at that point, the tigress recognized human flesh as a source of sustenance. A day later, she killed her third victim, this time deliberately, without provocation. From that point onward, she hunted humans regularly for food. Eventually, the Mukhtasar tigress would take 24 human lives before she was fatally shot by a hunter. Cases of man-eating cats were quite common in India from the late 19th century until the early 20th century. One could speculate that an expanding human population was encroaching upon big cat territory during that time, and the decrease in human attacks decades later could be attributed to the decline in the big cat population caused by that human encroachment. Corbett recalls first hearing of the Champawat man-eater while hunting with his buddy Eddie Knowles in Malani. Eddie was known throughout the area as an excellent hunter, but it was Eddie's brother-in-law who was reputed to be the best hunter in the world. He was commissioned by the British colonial government to find and kill the Champawat tiger. But the tiger had proven very difficult to kill. Great rewards were offered by the government for its hide. Special shikaris, or hunters, were employed to find and kill it, but none of these expeditions proved successful. The tiger managed to elude all who pursued her, and she was not only causing great anxiety for the colonial government, she kept the entire region of Kumeon in a state of paralytic fright. As it turned out, the Champawat tiger was not indigenous to the district of Champawat or the region of Kumeon. The tiger first appeared in the neighboring country of Nepal sometime prior to the turn of the century. There she claimed the lives of more than 200 human beings. After a long and fruitless search, the Nepalese army took care of the problem the best way they could think of. they chased the tiger into India, where it became their neighbor's problem. For 4 years, the tigress hunted and terrorized the people of Kumaon. In that time, she added another 234 victims to her total kills. The deputy commissioner of Nainital, the district neighboring Champawat, asked Corbett to take on the task of shooting the man-eating tigress. Corbett accepted the job on two conditions. One, that all rewards offered by the government be canceled. And two, that the local army unit be withdrawn. Corbett feared the unpredictable aim of other hunters more than he feared the tiger. He preferred to lead his own expedition and not have to worry about accidentally bumping into other parties. A week after accepting the commission, Corbett received news that the tiger had struck another victim in the village of Pali. He and his hunting party arrived at the scene of the killing 5 days later. Pali was a village of some 50 men, women, and children, and they were living in a state of abject terror. When Corbett entered Pali, all of the villagers were hiding inside their homes behind locked doors. The conditions in the central courtyard were completely unsanitary. Garbage and other debris were piling up. When the leery villagers approached the hunting party, they let it be known that no one had left their house for the last 5 days. Food and clean drinking water were running short, and if the tiger was not killed or driven away, they would all die. It was evident that the tiger was still in the vicinity, for its tremendous roar had been heard from more than 100 yards away, and she was seen prowling around the outskirts of the village. Noticing that there was a full moon that night, Corbett took advantage of the moonlight, knowing that tigers almost always attack during the day. Holed up in a tree, he waited for the lone tiger to approach. Instead of the man-eating tigress, he was dismayed to find a dozen tigers coming his way. He remained curled up in the tree, teeth chattering, till the tigers had passed and the dawn came. There, the members of his hunting party discovered him and expressed their surprise that he had managed to survive the night at all. Corbett asked the men of Pali to take him to the places where the tigress had killed their kin, but the villagers, out of fright, were unwilling to do this. Instead, they gave him directions to the site of the last attack and told him the circumstances of the young woman's death. On that day, she had been part of a group of young women and girls collecting oak leaves to feed their cattle. The woman was collecting leaves from a tree protruding out over the edge of a ravine. She was climbing down from the tree when the tiger silently approached, stood up on its hind legs, and grasped her by the ankle. The tiger pulled her into the ravine before suddenly releasing the woman's foot. The woman struggled to climb out of the ravine when the tiger struck again, this time grasping her by the throat. That proved to be the death blow. The tiger disappeared through heavy undergrowth on the other side of the ravine, with the body of the victim in her mouth. All of this was witnessed by two of the women in the leaf-gathering party. They and the rest of the group returned to the village at the first sign that the tiger had disappeared. The next day, the tiger was spotted a mere 30 yards away from Pali. 3 times a posse was assembled to dispatch the tiger, and 3 times the posse came running back to the village. On the last attempt, one villager discharged a rifle into the air to scare the animal away, but this only acted to enrage the tiger. When Corbett asked the villager why he hadn't aimed directly at the tiger, the man stated that he was too afraid, that if he had only wounded the tiger would have killed him. After an unsuccessful morning of tracking, Corbett was asked by the villagers to stand guard while they harvested their wheat. Corbett agreed, and the villagers were able to resupply their food stocks. They also used the time to clean up the unclean conditions in the village courtyard. Following a successful goat hunt that provided the village with more food and earned Corbett the confidence of the villagers, he selected a small party of locals to accompany him to the scene of the young woman's death and abduction. Searching the area of the ravine, Corbett was able to identify the pug marks or tracks of the tiger. From the pug marks, he could tell that the tiger was a female and advanced in years for a tiger. Corbett identified the area where the tiger had waited behind a rock for the young woman to climb down from the tree. He noticed strands of skin on the bark of the tree where the woman had struggled to maintain her grasp. At the base of the tree was a pool of dried blood. From there, he found a trail of dried blood stains that led out to the other side of the ravine and into some bushes where the tiger ate her victim. Corbett explains that a man-eating tiger, unlike human killers, will never return to the scene of a previous killing. With a domain of several hundred square miles, this made tracking extremely difficult. Also, as there had been no previously known tiger killings in Kumaon, Corbett had no one to turn to for advice. After several days of tracking without finding evidence of the tiger, Corbett was alerted to the tiger's presence by villagers 15 miles east of Pali, near a town named Champawat. En route to Champawat, Corbett was able to convince some 30 locals to join his hunting party. Some of these villagers had visited Champawat recently and told Corbett of an encounter they had on the way to the town. 2 months earlier, a party of 20 heard the agonized cries of a young woman coming from the valley beneath the ridge they were traveling along. The party cowered in fright as the young woman's cries drew nearer and nearer. Shortly thereafter, the tiger came into view, carrying the naked body of the woman in the jaws of its enormous mouth. The woman's long black hair was trailing on one side of the tiger and her feet on the other. The tiger had hold of her by the small of her back, and the still conscious woman was beating her chest and asking for help from man or God. The party of 20 men let the tiger pass. "And you did nothing?" Corbett asked. "No," the storyteller replied. "We were scared, and what could 20 unarmed men do that would not anger the tiger? The woman was so badly injured already she would never have survived." The traveling party met up with a group of people from the young woman's village. They proceeded to track the trail of the tiger, making loud noises and shooting off their guns as they traveled to scare off the tiger. A mile away from the village, they found the woman's body, lying on a slab of rock. The tiger had licked away all of the blood, but otherwise had not touched her body. Corbett identified with the fear the villagers felt, living year in and year out with the dangers of residing in tiger country. "The conviction I came to after a brief sojourn in that stricken land, that there is no more terrible thing than to live and have one's being under the shadow of a man-eater, has been strengthened by 32 years' subsequent experience." The next day, Corbett was visited by the Talsidar, or local administrator of Champawat. He arranged for Corbett to be put up in a bungalow near the site of many tiger killings. While at the bungalow, Corbett was approached by a panicked man from the village. The tiger had just attacked and killed another girl, a teenager of 16 to 17 years of age. Retrieving his Henry Martini rifle, Corbett followed the man to the site of the killing. The villager said the girl was with a group of about 12 others, gathering kindling when the tiger attacked. The man's wife, who witnessed the events as a member of the kindling gathering party, pointed out the tree to which the tiger had dragged the girl's body. Corbett set off in the direction of the tree, amazed that the tiger was able to approach the group from across open ground without being detected. He followed the trail of blood to the shoulder of a hill. The trail of the tiger was not difficult to follow, as the girl's flowing hair and dragging feet both left marks in the ground. Passing through a thicket of blackthorns, Corbett spotted the strands of the girl's raven-colored hair on the blackthorns. Quietly, Corbett and a companion sent by the Talsidar followed the tiger into the nettles. They followed the trail of blood through the hills, valleys, and ravines. Corbett's companion grew scared along the way, and it was agreed that he would climb up a precipice of rock some 30 feet high and wait for Corbett's return. The trail led to a small pool of water. The surrounding area was spattered with spots of blood. Corbett determined that his approach had disturbed the tiger from its meal, and she had run off with her prey. Splinters of bone were scattered about the pug marks. At the edge of the pool, he noticed a puzzling object, which turned out to be the young girl's leg. He felt a profound sadness for the girl whose leg had been cleaved clean off as though chopped through with an axe. Lost in the emotion of the moment, the quietness was suddenly broken by several stones plopping into the pool from a cliff above him. Corbett looked up to see the tiger standing at the top of this promontory no more than 15 feet away. While reaching for his rifle, the tiger turned and ran. Corbett made his way up the side of the cliff. Bent reeds, slowly returning to their natural position, indicated the tiger's recent path. He followed these reeds to a spot beneath an overhanging rock where the tiger had left her kill to spy on him. The tracks led into a wilderness of rocks and steep hillsides where the traveling became difficult and dangerous. With the tiger so close by, any misstep resulting in even minor injury would have been fatal. With Corbett moving slowly and cautiously, the tiger was able to stop and rest several times to continue her meal, each time leaving behind another pool of blood. The tiger, not accustomed to so persistent a pursuer, growled in an earth-trembling manner. This made the rough going only more difficult for Corbett, as he had been pursuing the tiger for the better part of the day. He determined he had no choice but to retrace his steps so that I could make it back to the village before darkness fell. Corbett retrieved his companion from the rock, who was only too happy to see him, thinking the growling had meant the tiger had taken another victim. Before returning, Corbett surveyed the countryside. The tiger would probably stay within the area to finish her meal. Her location was in a valley gorge flanked by mountain ridges. If Corbett could gather sufficient men, they would surround the perimeter and make enough noise to get the tiger to retreat through the one logical exit from the gorge. That night he met the Talsadar, back in the village. He asked the Talsadar to return to Champawat and gather as many men as he possibly could. The next morning the Talsadar returned with one man. None of this surprised Corbett, as the reputation of the tiger had instilled a deep, unnerving fear into the people of Kumeon. Eventually, word of the bravery of the Talsadar and his lone companion had gotten around, and other villagers joined the hunting party. By midday, they numbered nearly 300. The Talsadar let it be known that he would turn a blind eye to all unregistered firearms, and furthermore, he would provide ammunition to any man who brought a gun. Corbett and his party returned to the site where the girl was attacked. He lined the men up on either side of the ridge. He instructed them that when he waved his white handkerchief, they were to fire their weapons into the air, beat their drums, and roll rocks down into the gorge in order to corral the tiger toward the exit of the valley, and that no one was to leave their position until he personally came to retrieve them. Corbett proceeded with the Talsadar, who felt safer with the hunter and the tiger than he did with the uncertain aim of the members of the hunting party. Halfway through their journey and heading down a steep hill, the Talsadar stopped. Due to the fact he was wearing the wrong foot apparel for rock climbing, he could continue no further. While Corbett waited for the Talsadar to tend to his blisters, the men along the ridge may have thought that Corbett had forgotten to give the signal. They began firing their rifles and shouting at the top of their lungs. Still 150 yards away from the mouth of the gorge, Corbett raced at breakneck speed over terrain he had carefully traversed only the day before. At the mouth of the gorge, Corbett located a tall patch of grass thick enough to hide his presence. All was pandemonium, with the ear-piercing racket on the ridges above him. The men were firing their guns, beating their drums, rolling the stones, and shouting as loud as possible. Corbett caught sight of the tigress bounding down a grassy slope 300 yards to his right. At that moment, the Talsadar shot off both barrels of his gun. The sound of the blast caught the attention of the tiger. She whipped around and retreated the way she came. As she ducked for cover, Corbett took aim and shot at her, but his bullet missed its target. When men on the ridge heard the three gunshot blasts, they assumed Corbett had gotten his tiger. They shot the last of their ammunition and gave out a great yell. Corbett held his breath. He assumed the next sound he would hear would be that of screaming men being eaten alive by an angry tiger over on the tops of the ridges. Suddenly he saw the tiger break cover and charge across the stream to his left, and then head straight for his position at the mouth of the gorge. Corbett aimed and fired again. When the tiger stopped dead in her tracks, he assumed his aim had been too high. He had in fact hit the tiger, but a bit too far back for a kill shot. Lowering her head, she turned toward his position. This opened her up to Corbett, who wasted no time in getting off another shot. This time she was hit straight in the shoulder. The tigress flinched, but stood her ground with ears laid flat and teeth bared. Corbett contemplated his next move. He had only brought 3 cartridges. 2 were for the kill and 1 was for an emergency. As Corbett considered that his first attempt to kill a man-eater might turn out to be his last, he was amazed by a sight. The tiger had chosen not to charge his position, but rather to turn back toward the stream and seek a safe shelter. She found this beneath an overhanging rock. Revealing his precise location to the tiger, Corbett shouted to the Talsadar to bring him his gun. The Tal Sadar responded with a long-winded answer, of which the only part Corbett understood was the word feet. Corbett raced out in the open up the hill to where the Tal Sadar was still sitting, retrieved the man's gun, and raced back to the stream. When he returned, the Tigress was waiting for him on top of the overhanging rock. From 20 feet away, Corbett raised the gun and aimed. To his horror, he noticed that the gun had not been properly calibrated, and there was a danger of blowback that could blind him. He had no choice. With the wounded tiger such a short distance away, Corbett took aim with the Tal Sadar's weapon and fired at the tiger's head. The bullet missed its target and instead struck the tiger in the paw. That may have been the end for Corbett had the tiger not lost so much blood prior to his last shot. The great animal lurched forward and came to a rest with her head hanging over the edge of the rock. At the sight of the fallen animal, the men on the ridge let out a great shout and demanded that the demon beast be hacked to pieces. They came at her with axes, rusty swords, and spears. Corbett dashed toward the body of the fallen tiger, having not made any effort to ascertain whether the large cat was actually dead. He managed to get between the men and the tiger. He was going to need some evidence to show to the people of Kumeon that the great man-eater had in fact been killed. Eventually, nerves were settled, and the men of the hunting party begged for his forgiveness. Now able to fully examine the tiger, Corbett discovered that the lower and upper canine teeth in her mouth were broken away. It was a permanent injury and was most likely the result of a previous gunshot wound. The wound prevented the tiger from eating her natural prey and turned her into a man-eater out of necessity for survival. After a great celebration in Champawat, Corbett returned to his home in Nainital with the pelt of the great tiger in his saddlebag. Having read Corbett's story of his victory over the Champawat tiger, I couldn't help but wonder if this was some great fish story worthy of the old cartoon character Commander McBragg. Parts of his story just seem too incredible to be believed, but then I'm reminded of another story of a man and a Bengal tiger, The Life of Pi. That story ends with the reader accepting the incredible tale or completely denying it. But to deny the story is to shout out the beauty of the tale and its incredible revelation about the human spirit. Corbett may not have been all that, and the poor villagers of India may not have been that naive. But I do choose to believe in the power and intelligence of the Bengal tiger. When considering such tales, I'm also reminded, not that long ago, in 2008, a group of teenagers were so stupid as to taunt, hurl objects at, and dangle their legs over the walls of the Siberian tiger enclosure at the San Francisco Zoo. One of the tigers, Tatiana, attacked her tormentors, killing one of them. If someone can be that ignorant, given the strength, intelligence, quickness, and cunning of an adult tiger, I certainly don't see why there could not have been a hunter in India lucky and resourceful enough to stop one of these incredible beasts in her tracks. Please feel free to comment regarding your thoughts by emailing me at podcastofdoom@gmail.com or visit me at www.thepodcastofdoom.com. You can also follow me on Twitter or like me on Facebook. Please do like me on Facebook as I'm trying to earn enough likes to win a cat swiffer. Until next time, keep your ears pinned and your tail taut.